and welcome to the Albion Women's Show with myself, Dean Kilford, and the ever fantastic
Verity Gallagher. Hi, welcome to the show. Today we are joined by Jenna Legg.
Jenna, welcome to the show.
Hello, hello.
How are you doing?
Yeah, good, thank you.
Well, you didn't play on Sunday, and we sort of asked you before, but we'll let you explain to the viewers, because it was a surprise on the team sheet when your name wasn't called out. But
yeah.
Precautionary, we're here.
Yeah, obviously I was gutted not to be involved, but I'd taken a little knock in the friendly the weekend prior, so it was just, yeah, precautionary, just...
What happened?
It was innocent. It was just a 50-50 challenge. I came off worse, unfortunately. I just landed on my hip after a bit of a slide tackle. But yeah, these things happen.
Are you back, fit and fighting, ready for Watford on Sunday?
Yeah, I'll be ready to go on Sunday.
Happy days. Yeah. So your career, you've been in the game, the professional game, for such a long time. Mm-hmm. And different to a lot of the players that we've spoken to. You started... What age did you start at Chelsea?
14.
So from 14, yeah. And you went through the youth setup there.
Yeah.
And how was that? Because obviously they've been set up as a professional club for such a long time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was brilliant. Growing up, obviously, I couldn't have asked for a lot more. The facilities there were amazing. You know, and we were really fortunate as a club. And obviously the coaches and the calibre of players around you was brilliant. So yeah, I think it was the best thing for me growing up.
How did you get scouted? Because I'm guessing you're playing football long before then anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So what did you start off with?
So I actually started at Reading. I was there 7 or 8 seasons from obviously really young until 14. But the FA kind of changed the system and Reading actually lost their licence as an academy. And at the time, if you wanted to be involved with England, you had to be playing for an academy. So obviously I had to leave because obviously I wanted to do that. And yeah, obviously went for a trial at Chelsea and yeah.
Happy days.
Yeah.
So were you always playing for a women's team or did you have to, was it mixed before or?
When I was really young, I played for my local boys team and I was there a few seasons. But yeah, when I moved to Reading, it was obviously all girls.
Were you the only girl on the team?
I was, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I didn't mind it. It was good. Like, I was friends with all the boys anyway. And yeah, it was fine. Like, you know, when the teams would say, oh, there's a girl on the team. Like, you're obviously, you know, a little bit of pressure to perform. But yeah, I enjoyed it. It was good.
Did you feel like you got targeted? Do you think, because I just thought at that age, like as a boy, I'd be like, oh, girl playing the obviously, I'm going to target. did you feel like a lot of the play went through your way because of that or not? I don't know, I'm just trying to...
I suppose there is an element of that, like no boy wants to get beaten by a girl. But obviously for me, that's the best thing about it.
I think you did.
Yeah,
you're the one that's pro,
yeah.
You
know
how many
of them are. Yeah. No, I don't know.
And so was that, because you're from Reading, originally.
Yeah.
So was that a difficult decision? Obviously, you said you wanted to stay involved with the England setup.
Mm-hmm.
Was that a difficult decision to make from just having to travel for your family, or was it just like no-brainer? That's definitely what we're attempting to try and do.
Yeah, I mean, it was my childhood club. Like, I loved it there. But when these things happen, like, you have to make a decision, and I chose, and it was the best, you know, the best offer on the table at the time. And my family were really supportive. You know, they said, we'll take you. Obviously, needed lifts. I was at school and things like that, so it was difficult. But they were with me for every step of the way, and... Yeah, we made the decision.
So you stayed living up in Reading and you just commuted?
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah,
when did you actually move down?
When I went professional.
Oh, OK.
Yeah, I didn't move there until I was 18.
OK, so that was 2016?
So
yeah,
4 years, like 4 years there and then turned professional, is that right?
Yes. Four or five seasons.
And what was the setup there? Because obviously we know the setup down here, Brighton, and what planning to do, hopefully, with the application.
Mm-hmm.
Were you training in and around with the other academies, with the first team? Was there much interaction as a full club, or was it very much isolated? How did it work?
I wouldn't necessarily say isolated, but we did have our own section, which I think we were fortunate to have. We had our own hub, like a women's building, our own training pitches to play on, and stuff like that. So, yeah, we were really lucky in what we were given there.
And you were training almost every day, weren't you?
Yeah, every day. 6 days a week, in sort of 9 in the morning till 2, 3 in the afternoon.
So how does... That now, obviously, we'll skip a bit, but we'll go back.
Mm-hmm.
Now you're in an environment where you're only training 3 times a week.
Mm-hmm.
Does that difficult for you to adjust after years of playing every day?
Yeah, it was a huge change, obviously, to go from full-time to part-time. But I think, you know, it just means you've got to do it in your own time. You've got to make time to do it. And I'm obviously lucky enough to be on a contract here, so I can make this time in the day, just do my own gym sessions and things like that. So there are ways around it.
So how often do you find yourself training then?
I'd probably say like 5-6 sessions a week.
Okay, so yeah. How many of that is on your own and how many of that is with the team?
Probably 2 or 3 in my own time and then 3 sessions with the team.
A lot of dedication and commitment.
Yeah, yeah.
You've got to.
And when you were at Chelsea, was that because they are sort of the them and Arsenal ladies at the time would have been the two teams that you'd want to be involved in, the two best teams.
Yeah.
Was that hard to break through? Or did you find that a challenge? Was it? Did it? Did you sort of found it, find a sort of a hard wall to break through there?
Yeah, definitely. Obviously, coming out of the youth system, you go into like a reserves kind of team, and then you're always chomping at the bit to get in the first team after that. And the competition is, you know, it's massive. You're all fighting for contracts at the end of the day. And obviously, they've got strength in the squad there. It's crazy. But yeah, to get in and to break that as a young player is, yeah, it was really good.
I was going to say, it was off the back of a few of your reserve performances and some first-team performances that is actually what gave you professional contract. What was that like, the moment that you'd been working so hard, so long at that club, and you kind of just found out and then you're going to be signed for a professional?
Oh, it was amazing. Obviously, I was 17, 18 at the time, so I was so excited. It's everything that you've kind of worked for your whole kind of childhood, which you never really know kind of when it's going to come or if it's going to come. But to get, yeah, obviously, to get your first professional contract is amazing.
Was it a surprise? Did you have talks about it, or how did it go about?
Yeah, I think, obviously, it was always building up to a kind of meeting where you go in, you say, like, you just meet the manager and you don't really know whether you're going to get it, you're not going to get it, and then, yeah, it just kind of happens and you have the chat.
And alongside you at Chelsea, you were involved in the England setup for many years as well. Did that help, or which helped the other? Did playing for England help Chelsea, or did playing for Chelsea help England? What? Because it's quite an interesting scenario there with Chelsea being as obviously as big a club as they were.
Yeah, I think they kind of tie nicely together, obviously. Training around the best, you know, the best of the best at Chelsea, obviously, when I could take those experiences into England was brilliant. And then you obviously learn different things in an international environment. So to take that back to Chelsea, I think they kind of go nicely together.
And in terms of your England career, where is that with you? How close do you feel you are to getting back in with the first team squad?
Prior to my injury, I'd been on a 23s camp, which was great for me. Coming out of the 19s to get that call-up was brilliant. But yeah, my main focus is just to get fit, get playing regularly, stay injury-free, and then just if it comes, it comes. Obviously, I'd love to get back involved, but yeah.
So when exactly did you get injured then? When was...?
April of last year.
And you had an ankle ligament injury?
Yeah, I tore my ankle ligaments.
So this is when... So yourself and Laura Rafferty's career kind of twinned in quite nicely. You'd both just signed at the time for Oxford United, is that right?
On loan? Yeah, we'd gone on a loan.
Both gone on loan.
Yeah.
And then you never actually kicked a ball for them.
No, I was so unfortunate. I had been out with an injury and I was looking to come back to start playing again at Oxford. But I took a setback, which, it knocked me out for the rest of the season, unfortunately. I never got to play for them. But
when you say a setback, what happened?
I re-tore my ligament, so I was getting back
too soon,
It was just in a session, always the way it is. I'd done the whole session and it was the last strike, the last tackle, and just caught me. But
and how does that make you reassess everything as a person? Did you were you just make you more determined to get back and fit, or did you have sort of days where you're like, oh, why me? What?
Yeah, I think there's highs and lows with every injury. Like, you do everything you can to stay positive, but the reality of it is really hard. I think it goes a little bit unappreciated how hard injuries are, like mentally especially. But it takes a lot of strength and obviously resilience to come back from things like that and stay positive. So
what was Oxford United like when you did kind of re-injure yourself? Because obviously you were there to play for them and were they accommodating or how?
Yeah, they were so supportive along the way and understanding. Obviously, they were disappointed that I wasn't going to be able to go there. But, you know, they just said, take your time, do what's right. You know, your health, your fitness is more important than anything. So, yeah, they were really good about it.
Are you good at watching football?
I mean, I've learned to be very good at watching football.
Because there are some players that just, like, that literally they can't. Like, if they're not playing, they just don't want to...
Yeah,
see, and
I think, you know, sometimes out of sight, out of mind would be easier, but I think it's so important to stay around the team. You know, you've got to keep showing your face, you have to keep saying.
What kind of supporter are you?
On the bench, I get right involved. Yeah, you have to, yeah.
And I suppose, do you have an affinity now with Oxford United because of that? I know you didn't actually get to play with them, but from watching and being around the club, will they always have like a little place for you?
Yeah, of course. Like, I got to know a lot of the girls. Obviously, I'm really good friends with Vinny now, who came from there and things like that. And the girls were always lovely to me. So, yeah.
You've, of course, played now against both your old clubs.
Mm-hmm.
What was that like, going out against Chelsea, first of all?
Yeah, it was fine. Like, that was obviously always going to be a massive challenge for us. But they're the games we like. Like, you know, that's what you play for in football. You want to play against the best. We wanted to test ourselves. And obviously, I know a lot of the girls, so... Yeah, it was always going to be interesting, but I think we did really well.
Awesome. Oh, just going to hold it there, because we're going to go to a break, but we'll talk about your move to Brighton and then a bit more in depth after these ads. Join us after the break. Hello and welcome back to the Albion Women's Show. We're, of course, joined by Jenna Legg. Jenna, just before the break, we were talking about playing against your former clubs. And it's being somewhere for such a long period of time, does that give you an insight? Do you sort of like, I know what this person is. Like, if you were to play against Innie, even though you didn't play against her, but you
stay away.
But you watched her every week at Oxford for the whole spring series, so you'd be able to go, oh, I know where she's going to barge you over. No, I'm joking.
Yeah, of course. I mean, obviously, you know, playing with them every day for that amount of time, you do get to learn, you know, little things about them, and obviously, I take that into the changing rooms, I say to the girls, but. Yeah, of course, on the day, it's 11v11. Like, you can't predict what they're going to do. So.
But it's loads of you from Chelsea, down there.
Yeah, there's
yourself,
I suppose,
Laura joining at the same day, Danny.
Sophie had a Sophie, well, yeah.
What is it like moving with someone? Because you and Laura have literally been together in your careers so much. Is that going to make it easier for you? Is it just nice having someone there when you move?
Yeah, obviously always having a familiar face is nice, and you're in the same boat. Obviously going into a new team, it's always nice to have someone you already know. So yeah, it is always nice
and
to have someone supporting you.
And how did it come about, the fact that you guys just moved together?
We left Chelsea at the same time, obviously both searching for new clubs, both kind of free agents in that sense. And George actually just rang us both separately, said, would you be interested in coming down? Yeah, we both just came a look, and at the time, you know, Brighton are a brilliant club. It was the best offer for both of us, so yeah.
And you've been playing a bit of a new position at Brighton, because you, I think, you once in an interview, midfield was your preferred position.
Yeah.
So, kind of, how has the change come about? Because you're quite a versatile player. So, what is it like? What's it like being in defence, and, you know, where do you like to be on the pitch?
Obviously, midfield is my preferred position, but when I first moved, you know, we had a couple of injuries and there was like a lot of movement in the squad, so I just had to do a job at right back, which is fine. Like, I don't mind doing that. I played there a little bit before, so it's fine. You do a job. That's the way it is. But yeah, midfield is
you
my
preferred
position.
You want to get back
into it?
Yeah.
Hope if you're listening.
Why so much though? Why do you like being up front? Do you like attacking? Do you like going to do the goals, score the goals and stuff like that? Or
I think I like combination football. I like linking up with forwards, and I think the attacking side of the game is the exciting part for me.
But then fullbacks now, as the game's evolving, are probably the most attacking part.
Yeah,
can be
that's the exciting part for me.
And is that because we've seen the way that sort of we set up over different games? Sometimes you've. Particularly in Sheffield, you were urged to go forward whenever you could do. Obviously, after the wind allowed that to happen. So are you encouraged to go forward as a defender? Or not?
I've actually been playing in midfield recently. And I was in midfield in the Sheffield game. But yeah, our fullbacks are always encouraged to get on. Like, we're an attacking team. We like to have the ball and we like to play exciting football. So yeah, we are encouraged, obviously, to get on.
But is it not tough just switching? Like, do you have, like, set tactics at the back, set tactics in midfield? Is it not tough for you then, because you kind of interlink of new players and stuff like that? Does that not kind of, I don't know, mess with your head or something?
Yeah, obviously playing in different positions is always different. Like, fullback is very different from midfield.
Yeah.
You can obviously take elements of it, like it's good. I've obviously liked to play under pressure, so you can take that. There are obviously aspects of every position that are transferable. So, yeah, you just kind of do your job.
Do what you do.
Yeah.
And with the team and with the players and with the squads, how, and we have to talk about this, how disappointing was last Sunday? Because just a goal defeat, you'd still be in the competition.
Yeah.
But obviously the 3-0 defeat, and are the squad disappointed? Are realistic to know that Bristol are a good team? How are the squad feeling?
Yeah, no, obviously we were disappointed. Obviously nobody likes to lose 3-0. It wasn't a very flattering scoreline. But I think it speaks volumes, you know. We went into that game hoping to get a result. when realistically, you know, they are full-time professionals, they train every day, they are a WSL one side. And for us, you know, to expect, you know, to beat and compete with teams like that, you know, is good. But yeah, obviously got to come away with a loss at the end of the day.
You were in a tough group, and I mean, mm-hmm. you won two, Tottenham and
Yeovil.
Yeah. And then you just lost two. So I guess looking back on it, you can't be too hard on yourselves. You gave it a really good go.
Yeah, I think we should be proud of how we did. You know, obviously we got the two wins, and I think we did compete really well against the higher opposition. But yeah,
like. And now it's like looking back, it's the two late goals against Yeovil that the distance, the difference.
Oh yeah, well, when you put it like that, that is frustrating. That is frustrating.
But just for it to be like, you know, depending on how Tottenham Chelsea go, to potentially just lose out on goal difference.
It is so tight.
But it is all such tight leagues. Like, even in the league, it's all so tight. I think it's just 1 point between the top. Like, three of you are all on 10.
Frustrating. Giving my anger face. Speaking of, it's not linked at all, but I'm going to introduce it anyway. The squads, competitive squad that we've got at the club.
Yeah.
We had the Players Challenge.
We did.
Which I know you're looking forward to seeing.
Yep.
You're very much looking forward to seeing. So let's roll the clip right now and let's talk through it.
Jenna Legg, 14, centre midfield.
Okay.
We haven't seen this yet, Verity.
No, I'm excited.
What's going through your mind?
I'm just thinking, curl it in.
Concentration.
Don't miss. See, that's close, that's not too bad. These are shameful.
Are they?
Yeah. I don't hit the bar. Terrible.
You're just getting really great, easy goals.
Consistent
really.
In the goal. I'm just taking the points. I played it safe. That one's a little bit closer.
On to 3 points.
And this one, I'm thinking, oh wow.
What are you thinking?
Lefty.
Here?
I've gone lefty. Paul.
It's the side netting. There's still a smile on your face.
Shame.
There's still a smile on your face.
That's because I don't know how anyone else did.
So, when we look at the leaderboards at the end of that,
I'll be
3 points.
Holding it up, I'm sure.
It does sadly lead you at the bottom of the table, I'm sorry to say.
Take on for the team, someone's got to do it.
Take on for the team, that's it.
You're not going to win matches by hitting the crossbar
exactly.
Anyway.
No, so I went for the goal, didn't I?
It's the goalkeepers. They're the ones that the goalkeepers are absolutely...
They've done so
They have.
They're competitive. They're really competitive.
Yeah, they are.
Which everyone we've had this show has all had like that streak in them that just wants to win. Fight.
Not this time, but the next challenge.
I'm in it for the next one.
We're just prepping. What is the challenge?
But moving down to Brighton, with the players, now, do you live in essentially like a player's house, which sounds awesome.
Yeah.
So just talk us through that.
So it's me, Innie, Danny Buer and Laura Rafferty. We all live together and it's brilliant.
Like, so what's the house like? Do you all have like your roles? Is someone the mum of the house?
Do it.
Really?
Yeah, of course she is.
Okay, is someone the cook?
Well, Buett's the best cook, but we don't ever get to taste Buett's food. Like, that's for Buett when she cooks.
Oh, she gets right.
Me and Innie do a little bit of sharing. But yeah, other than that, no, Dan's the chef. But yeah.
Who's the cleanest in the house? Who's the messiest?
Who's the messiest?
Oh, it's going to be Innie. That's my guess. I've just got a feeling.
Yeah, we'll give Innie that title.
I'm sorry.
Bless her. I thought I even called it before it was even said.
Well, I just felt like
just felt like you had it in her. She's spicy.
And do you have a lot of fun? Is it like a party? Not a party house, obviously.
Obviously, you can't drink anything.
Lots of fun, lots of... it must be good for team spirit and team building.
Yeah, it is brilliant. Like, obviously, being around your teammates all the time, like, you get to know them. And it's such a laugh. Yeah, they are really nice. I'm fortunate to have such good housemates. And the friendships we've made are brilliant, yeah.
And a long commute to the training ground.
Yeah, quick walk out the back door.
Are you ever late?
Literally, never. I don't think the girls would ever forgive us when they're travelling, you know, driving down. Yeah. I think if we were ever late. No.
It's just like, it tends to be the people that live the closest. Yeah. Just always just leave it to the last minute.
Oh, that's Innie. Yeah. Lastminute.com. I'm always like, come on.
Lastminute.com.
Literally, get your bag. We need to go. So, yeah.
Poor Innie.
Yeah, it's just it. Yeah.
Right.
I was going to say, that just must have made the move just so much easier. And the club set that up for you, didn't they?
Yeah. Yeah, they did. Yeah, we've been so fortunate, obviously, you know, with them giving us the house, it's the best thing for us. So, yeah, we are really lucky to have it.
Amazing.
Well, We've got about a minute or so left of the show, so I
think
it's time to ask quick-fire questions.
Oh, well,
I'm going to be kind today.
Yeah.
And so the first one we're going to do is seaside or countryside?
Seaside.
Your first pet?
A cat.
A cat. What's the cat's name?
Moby.
Moby the cat.
Yeah, Moby the cat.
I like that. Sunday roast or Sunday breakfast?
Sunday roast.
Favourite TV show?
Stranger Things at the minute.
Oh, I've heard it's so good.
It's very good.
Yeah, favourite movie?
Pretty Woman. Old school.
Yeah. Classic.
It's a classic.
Favourite actress ever?
Favourite ever? That's Julia Roberts.
Classic. Yeah, she's great.
Favourite footballer?
Dennis Bergkamp.
Oh,
yeah.
Nice.
I grew up watching him, so he's my favourite, yeah.
So your biggest inspiration is no longer Bex?
No more, that's no more.
God, if he's watching this show,
sorry.
That would be
brilliant. I'm sure.
And is your nickname still Leggy?
Yeah.
Leggy. Oh, yeah. It's been brilliant to have you on the show.
Thank you.
Stay tuned next week as we join you for another Albion Women's Show.